From the earliest days, the Western has been the bread and butter movie of the film industry. From 1913 to the present, Hollywood has produced over 2,000 feature films on cowboys and Indians. The idea that Indians are quaint and strange, but not quite human, is an idea created and perpetuated by Hollywood movies.
Hello, my name is Will Sampson. Movies have consistently portrayed the Indian as savage, a renegade, a killer of innocent pioneer women and children, and merciless scalper who used the most cruel means of torture in his vicious attacks against white men. This series of programs intends to give a look as to how and why it happened, and the fact that these Hollywood images are seen nightly on television screens all over the world is having on our people, especially our young people. You know, for most people, the Native American is invisible unless he looks like the Hollywood Indian.
We waited years for you to say that you were wrong to have pictured us this way. But it's too late, the time has come for all false images to come undone.
In the movies, the dominant image is the warrior, the enemy, menacing, cunning, sneaky, and barbarous. The Indian wars are long over, but not the war of the Indian self-image, which began with the early image makers, the painters, the novelists, and Wild West shows. The Western dime novel appeared in 1860, and its impact was enormous. So great that 50 years later, these novels provided the first Western movie scripts. 400,000 copies of Seth Jones were sold in 1860. The story dealt with a white family taken captive by cruel Indians. The success of the dime novel continued into the 1930s, when they were selling at the rate of 10 million a month. The dime novels were also the basis for the Wild West shows. From 1870 to 1900, there were 150 Wild West shows touring the world. The most famous belonged to William F. Cody, Buffalo Bill. Once an Indian scout for the army, he later earned his nickname Slaughtering Buffalo for their hides. Buffalo Bill is a very important figure for the Indians. He symbolizes the destruction of their food supply, the buffalo. And perhaps even more importantly, he symbolizes the creation of a false Indian image. For to make Buffalo Bill a hero, the Indian had to play the loser. Buffalo Bill, here played by Joel McRae, was a manufactured hero of Arthur Ned Buntline, who created fictitious deeds for Cody to perform. These became the basis for countless dime novels, books, and movies. His Wild West shows, capitalizing on the writing skills and business naivety of the Native Americans, netted Cody personally $1 million a year.
You knew Buffalo Bill Cody,
yes,
did you?
Yes, I did, yes.
Did you also know Sitting Bull?
No, the son of Sitting Bull I knew, of course. Uh-huh. John Sitting Bull, his son. He, in fact, people don't realize this, but he had old Sitting Bull
mm-hmm. yeah.
on the show with him for 2 years, you know.
Mm-hmm. Well, what kind of man was Cody?
Cody, you know, he's been so maligned. They'd really mm-hmm. done a superb showman. And naturally, as a showman, he did the things that a showman has to do. He was flamboyant. He could take stage anywhere. He couldn't walk into this room if he didn't take stage.
I see.
It was just perfectly natural for him. And in spite of the fact that a lot of people portray him in strange ways, it's not true, because sure, he was a showman 24 hours a day. That's what made him great.
Mm-hmm.
I remember he said one time, somebody asked him a question about certain exploits. He said, "You know, I have read so much of my own publicity and have read these dive novels and all these things that half of these things I don't know whether I did them or not."
The idea of a hero who couldn't tell whether or not the events of his life were real caught the attention of screenwriter Gene Fowler.
"Wait, don't fire, she's holding a penny." Fowler and director William Wellman set out to do a movie on a phony hero.
Shoot, Bill.
But it turned out differently.
Now, Fowler was, to me, one of the most brilliant writers, but he hated picture writing. So I went up, and he opened the drawer, and he brought out at least a sheath of papers that thick on Buffalo Bill, the real Buffalo Bill, that he'd been saving and writing on for years. And he said, I want to write a story and make a picture on the fakiest guy that ever lived, Buffalo Bill. And boy, I'm telling you, when we got into that thing, it was true. So we worked on it. We worked on it for almost 3 months. We had a half a script. It was absolutely beautiful. And one day he called me up and he was loaded. And he says, come on up here, you son. So I walked up to that place. I said, what's wrong? It was in the winter. And he had a lovely den, a little fireplace there. It was going. He said, Bill, you know, you couldn't stab Babe Ruth. You can't kill Dempsey. You can't kill any of these wonderful heroes that our kids, my kids, your kids, my grandchildren, your grandchildren, everything else will worship and like. And that's what we're doing. Buffalo Bill is a great figure, and we cannot do it. What do you say? What do we do? I said, just burn the goddamn thing. So early in the morning, we got drunk, and we put them in, page after page, and burned up 3 months of the most wonderful work that I've ever done with a writer in my whole life.
To get money for his picture, The Oxbow Incident, Wellman made a deal to make two films for Daryl Zanuck. Ironically, one was a heroic version of Buffalo Bill. Instead of the debunking movie he had once wanted to make, Wellman found himself adding to the myth of the great white hero, a myth which left only stereotype roles for the Indian. Because of what he knew of the real Buffalo Bill, this was a hard movie for him to make. But he kept his bargain. And once again, Hollywood fantasy won over a true story.
The show which you have seen tonight has lived a long time because it found a place in your hearts. But now, the time has come to say not good night, as on former occasions, but goodbye. My little comrades, up in the gallery, and you grown-ups who used to sit there.
I said, do I have to shoot this? I went to Zanuck. I said, look, will you get someone else? Will you come out and do it for God? He says, remember, we made a deal.
Goodbye. God bless you.
And God bless you too, Buffalo Bill.
I tried to do the best I could with it, but when that poor little crippled kid at the end stands up and said, God bless you, Buffalo Bill. I almost, honestly and truly, I turned around and damn near vomited. Oh, that poor little crippled kid. God bless you, Buffalo Bill. And then Zanuck told me later on, years later on, not too long, he said, you know, it was the second biggest money maker that we've ever made.
The most colorful redskin alive. Here he comes. The battling chief of the Hunk Papa Sioux.
Finally, in 1975, with the film Buffalo Bill and the Indians, director Robert Altman did attempt the true story of Buffalo Bill. He contrasted the fakery of Buffalo Bill against the spiritual power of Sitting Bull. Even with top star Paul Newman as Buffalo Bill, it failed at the box office.
Thank you.
James Cruise's great epic film, The Covered Wagon, made in 1923, used train loads of Arapahoes, Bannocks, and Shoshones brought to Hollywood by the Adjutant General of Wyoming, Colonel Tim McCoy. McCoy later toured Europe with his own Wild West show and became a famous Western movie star.
You were instrumental in having Indians play Indians in the movies.
That is the point.
What kind of transaction did you have to go about to get these people?
Well, I had a difficult time first because I wanted all the old-timers, all the old long hairs. Now, they had been fooled so often that they were a little bit skeptical about this thing. And I ran into some very strange things. Those old, old men, you know, one of them up among the Bannocks. I'd have to go into council, as you know, to talk to these fellows to find out who wants to go, who doesn't. This old fellow said, I think it's just another plan on the part of the government to get us down, since I said it was the other side of the Salt Lake. That's the only way I could explain to them.
I see.
He said, I think this is another plan. And when we get down there above that Salt Lake, they're going to throw us all in that Salt Lake, and we're never going to come back again, and they'll take our reservation away.
Hollywood's avalanche of Westerns had no interest in Indians as people. What sold was warriors and battles. In 1924, The Iron Horse, with its great battle scenes, marked the film debut of director John Ford. Ford became Hollywood's foremost director of Westerns, and his movies set the format for the role of the Indian for years to come. Indians became devices for advancing the plot. They were the enemy, providing necessary action for the manifest destiny of whites as they moved west. Indians became mere bodies to be shot from horses, kicked from doorways, or supplying comic relief as mindless drunks and inept buffoons. John Ford also discovered Monument Valley as the best location for the action western. Hollywood soon transported nearly all cowboy Indian movies to this one locale. And so here in beautiful Monument Valley, many warriors rose and fell on film. Although it's in the heart of the Navajo Nation, Monument Valley became the Great Plains, the Rockies, the buttes of Montana, the hills of South Dakota. All tribes lived and died here. It's as if in our time, all the citizens of the great cities of the world were portrayed as living in Paris. I asked noted Sioux author Vine DeLaurier Jr. his views on movie misrepresentation of the Native American.
Well, my people beat the United States cavalry probably more than any other tribe of Indians. I think the warrior image was the most attractive one for writers and film people. But it's one thing being a warrior, it's another thing being accurate. It's very difficult when almost all of the dramatic storylines are written so that Indians lose. If you actually would film history, Indians would win most of the time. I think a lot of the misrepresentation is a failure to really understand history, to know what happened.
Mm-hmm.
So many good things could have been done and could still be done if they're historically accurate. History is always more important than fantasy. But it can't be done by someone sitting in an air-conditioned building fantasizing about what he thinks Indians are.
Signal smokes, war drums, feathered bonnets against the western sky. New messiahs, young leaders are ready to hurl the finest light cavalry in the world against Fort Stark.
In John Ford, she wore a yellow ribbon. Plains Indians were transported to Navajo country. And the movie allied tribes that were never known to fight together.
The beat of the drums echoes in the pulse beat of the young braves. Fighters under a common banner, old quarrels forgotten, Comanche rides with Arapaho, Apache with Cheyenne. All chant of war.
And you get a second-rate filmmaker, and then he's the one that creates the bad stereotypes, transports tribes back and forth across the continent, pays no attention to authentic costuming, and a lot of times, I think, projects values of white society into Indian society. And more often, people coming in from the outside have in their own mind some gimmick that they need to do dramatically. And I think they twist Indian culture to fit that gimmick.
In the way west, Richard Widmark, Kirk Douglas, and Robert Mitchum lead a wagon train to Oregon. One of the party accidentally kills an Indian boy. The Sioux chief, whose son it is, relentlessly pursues them. The following scene typifies Hollywood's approach to Indian culture. The supposed Sioux chief's hairdo is simulated mohawk. His shawl is woman's dress. Men never wore them. The dead boy's beard seems Mexican, as do his clothes. The mask appears to be Northeastern spirit mask, but they were never used on the dead. And the idea of dragging a dead boy miles for revenge is repugnant to the Sioux people. Their way was to quickly return a dead body to Mother Earth. The language is a kind of Lakota. We asked a Sioux translator to translate the scene. In reality, he said, the words don't go together, but this is what they mean.
It's the big chief of the whole Sioux nation? What did he want?
Oshichu. Akuyashne.
He wants justice.
Wanachante.
He says he may die of grief. However, he wants no blood of ours. We may go unharmed. But this is his son, and he can't bury him until the boy sees the man who murdered him killed.
Colonel, King Vidor, the director, once said that Hollywood stereotyped the Indians because they had no lobby. What's this about? What can you tell?
Well, I never heard it put that way, but there was no one down there to speak for the Indian. There were people for the different ethnic groups, things of that sort, but there was no one to speak for the Indian. There was no one who cared much about how they portrayed the Indian, because the Indian didn't have anybody fighting for him. You could try to portray any other ethnic group, let's say, and there was always somebody to get up in arms and say, you can't show us that way. We're not that way at all. And even today, you know, that is so true with people like, Al Jolson. Any of those people couldn't be allowed to perform today. But the Indian, nobody cared about the Indian. Mm-hmm. So they portrayed the Indian, as I said a moment ago, either doing a stomp dance or circling a wagon train or something of that sort. And half the time, when I first came down here, those who portrayed Indians were probably mostly Mexicans or moving picture extras covered with bulimia and wigs.
We did a screen test for looks, and I had learned how to wear black, we call them contact lenses. Very dark contact lenses, so I wouldn't have blue eyes. And the producer came to me after I did the test while the camera was still there, and he said to me, Chuck, he says, take the lenses out and do the test again with your own eyes. And I did, with my blue eyes. And when we saw the stuff in the rushes the next day, even though the black eyes were more authentic, the thinking was lost. In other words, it was a blank expression in my eyes, no matter what I was feeling. But with my blue eyes, you can see the spark and the what have you. He says, well, we're going with the blue eyes.
Mm-hmm.
Chuck, were there any Apaches in Geronimo?
Well, there were a lot of... Most of the extra people in smaller parts were played by Mexican nationals, many of whom had Indian blood in them.
That long hair returned with word of great white father that no white man will set foot on sacred soil. And Crazy Horse and his brothers will smoke peace pipe forever.
If the great white father gives word to my brother's people, then Long Hair and his long knives will defend Black Hills against all white men who seek to profane them. That is the word of Long Hair.
Long Hair's word, good word. But the word of the great white father's broken word. Hear me now, Long Hair. If this word broken now, not only Sioux, but the Cheyenne, the Oglala, the Minneconjo, the Blackfeet, the San Zox, and every living tribe between mountains and great waters will gather in one last battle.
And they died with their boots on, with Errol Flynn and Anthony Quinn. Indian hero Crazy Horse is degraded in the dialogue to the point that he speaks of his own people as if there were other tribes. The Oglala, San Zark, and Minneconjo are all bands of the Sioux tribe. George Armstrong Custer was another movie hero built at the expense of Indian dignity. After winning the Battle of Little Bighorn, Indians have had to contend with the Custer myth that he was a friend to Indians when in reality he was an Indian killer who broke his word to the Cheyenne. That he tried to protect the Black Hills when in actuality he pioneered the white invasion for gold. For years, the myth conditioned white feeling against Indians. And as late as 1920, any Indian admitting involvement in the battle was subject to a prison term.
Custer is dead. And around the bloody guidon of the immortal 7th Cavalry lie 212 officers and men. The Sioux and Cheyenne are on the war. Pony Express riders know that one more such defeat as Custer's, and it would be 100 years before another wagon train dared to cross the plains. And from the Canadian border to the Rio Bravo, 10,000 Indians, Kiowa, Comanche, Arapaho, Sioux, and Apache, under Sitting Bull and Crazy Horse, Gaul and Crow King, are uniting in a common war against the United States cavalry.
I asked Martina Sherwood, who is 97, and who, as a little girl, personally knew Sitting Bull and Gaul, if the Sioux were looking to fight Custer.
They sure were not. You know, they wanted, the government wanted them to settle on the reservation, you know, and settle down. But as I say, their nature children, they had to be patient with them. They just want to, you know, get off again and do like old times, right? So they'd get away. And they weren't looking for any fight. My mother said the women right away started to break camp and get their kids ready and everything. And the men went up to defend their families. They weren't looking for a fight. But when they got up there, Sir Prehaska with his troops, that they were all come ready to fight them, they had to fight back. They were up against the wall. What could they do? So they fought, and they annihilated them. They killed them all.
Television today, national airwaves, in very short order, you can create all kinds of trauma because Indian communities, the older people are teaching the younger people the traditions of the tribe, yet those kids can turn on the television set and see a different type of Indian. And that type of Indian is the type that the white public accepts. The children are faced with two types of authority, the authority of their parents and community and Indian tradition, and that electronic authority that pokes itself into everybody's television set and that you see on the screen. And a lot of film is made and advertised as if it was authentic. So children, particularly Indian children, have a very difficult time. They know what they experience in those communities among their own people, but they also know that there's this electronic authority that's telling everybody the Indians are something else, and it's very difficult to reconcile that. So you have a tremendously detrimental feedback from television and movies against the foundations of Indian culture. It's a creation of a general movie Indian rather than Indians of any particular tribe.
Hollywood made some notable attempts to portray Indian leaders sympathetically. Jeff Chandler as Cochise in Broken Arrow, Chuck Connors as Geronimo, Chief Dan George as the Cheyenne Chief in Little Big Man, and for television, Ned Romero as Chief Joseph of the Nez Perce. But these attempts were always from the non-Indian point of view. This film, Standing Tall, about two Indian ranchers in a struggle to keep their land and livelihood, is one of the few that treats Indians as real people. Hopefully, it is a growing trend.
Why are you trying to be a white man?
I ain't trying to be a white man.
What do you want, then?
Well, I guess I want the same as everybody else.
Truth, the lost from sight, will change the world when it's finally brought to light. So we say again that all false images must come to an end.
From the earliest days, the Western has been the bread and butter movie of the film industry. From 1913 to the present, Hollywood has produced over 2,000 feature films on cowboys and Indians. The idea that Indians are quaint and strange, but not quite human, is an idea created and perpetuated by Hollywood movies.
What? Great!
Hello, I'm Will Sampson. The movies have consistently shown the Indian as a savage warrior, a renegade, a killer of innocent pioneer women and children, and a merciless scalper who used the most cruel means of torture in his vicious attacks against the white man. That is the legacy that Hollywood has left the Indian people. It is our worldwide image. This is the second in a series of programs dealing with how and why it came about and examining the effects that these Hollywood images, which are seen nightly on television and movie screens throughout the world, is having on our people, especially our youngsters. You know, for most people, the Native American remains invisible unless he looks like the Hollywood Indian.
We waited years for you to say that you were wrong to have pictured us this way. But it's too late, the time has come for all false images to come undone.
When you
you get next to one another is everybody needs some elbow room, elbow room. It's nice when you're kind of cozy, but not when you're tangled nose to nosy. Oh, everybody needs some elbow, needs a little elbow room. That's how it was in the early days of the USA. The people kept a-coming to settle, though the East was the only place there was to go. The president was Thomas Jefferson. He made a deal with Napoleon. How'd you like to sell a mile or two?
Or three, or 100, or 1,000?
And so, in 1803, the Louisiana Territory was sold to us without a fuss and gave us lots of elbow room. Oh, elbow room, elbow room. Got to get us some elbow room. It's the West or bust. In God we trust. There's a new land out there. Lewis and Clark volunteered to go. Goodbye, good luck, wear your overcoat. They prepared for good times and for bad, and for bad. They hired a Sacagawea to be their guide. She led them all across the countryside, reached the coast, and found the most elbow room we've ever had.
Attributing one of the most powerful and controversial historical dramas ever played by man to the simple need for elbow room is a grotesque distortion of reality. Millions of children watching Saturday morning TV are repeatedly taught that Indians, like high mountains, raging rivers, blazing hot deserts, are just inconvenient stumbling blocks to be overcome on the white man's road to progress.
Well, there were plenty of fights to win land rights, but the West was meant to be. It was a manifest destiny. The trappers, traders, and the peddlers, the politicians, and the settlers.
Oh, everyone was in on the good part was gone.
Come on, kids, come into the dining room.
I want
to show you something. Okay, kids. Before we talk about how Hollywood has rewritten history, I think we should look at some of the major events that led up to the great expansion west that movie makers have been so fascinated with for over 70 years. This is the way it pretty much was when the Pilgrims first landed here. The Wampanoag Nation here, the Iroquois Confederacy here. There were numerous small tribes populating the eastern seaboard, although many of them were wiped out when colonization began. The Pilgrims relied quite heavily on Indian friendship. The Indians fed them, protected them, and gave them their democratic form of government. With nothing in the European political experience of empires and kingdoms to equal the democratic constitution of the Iroquois Confederacy, Benjamin Franklin used it as a model for the Articles of Confederation, the forerunner of the United States Constitution, with its provisions for initiative, referendum, and recall, suffrage for women as well as men. The pattern of states within a state that we call federalism, the habit of treating chiefs as servants instead of masters, and the insistence that the community must respect the diversity of men and the diversity of their dreams. There's little wonder that the greatest teachers of American democracy went to school with the Indians. Indians were then used as pawns in the Revolutionary War by both sides. The Americans gained their Indian allies with promises and treaties guaranteeing the tribes equal status with the colonies, recognizing both their rights and property. The British enlisted the aid of some tribes by promising to limit colonial expansion west. But when the shooting was over, all the promises were forgotten in the rush to steal the land. This film, as most about this period in history, only show the Indians as enemies of the Americans.
However, in this case, made a good beginning.
I'd say it was more than that, sir.
We paid $15 million, and we got a lot of real estate. We know it stretches from the Mississippi River to the Continental Divide. That's all we do know about it.
In the teacher's guide that goes out with the elbow room film to the public schools,
which says that it was our manifest destiny to overspread the continent allotted by Providence for the free development of our multiplying millions. What about manifest destiny of the Native Americans? Who gave Napoleon the right to sell the land, or Jefferson the right to buy it?
But we don't own that territory.
Neither does anyone else. That's the point.
No one seriously considered the Native American's right to own his own homeland. All the European had to do was to walk through it, and it was his. That's manifest destiny.
By right of exploration, I claim for the United States of America all the land we have traveled, from the Rocky Mountains to the Pacific Ocean.
Tribe after tribe and nation after nation succumbed to the relentless acquisition of their lands. They were forced to cede the properties for no more than the promise that if they moved farther west, they would never be bothered again. But in the early 1800s, literally millions of immigrants flooded our shores, and their lust for elbow room was insatiable.
Indian removal was effected in a haphazard manner for several years until it was established as a national policy with the election of General Andrew Jackson as President of the United States. The southern states had been trying desperately to get the southern tribes moved off their traditional homelands. To that end, they brought tremendous pressure to bear upon the federal government.
Mr. President, the state of Georgia has enacted legislation making it illegal for an Indian to testify in a court of law.
Sir, in their eagerness to expel the Indians from their state, they've clearly ignored the provisions of the Hopewell Treaty, and they've overstepped the bounds of states' rights.
Gentlemen, in spite of the promises made in the Hopewell Treaty of 1785, or the Georgia Pact of 1802. If the state of Georgia wishes to extend her laws over the Indians within her borders, to expel them from the state, to dissolve their governments, it's a legitimate exercise of state sovereignty, and we should not interfere. The only solution to the Indian problem is to remove them to that territory west of the Mississippi called Oklahoma. It's only for their own good.
It didn't really matter that these tribes were advanced in learning and permanently established on the soil, or that they'd built homes, towns, roads, mills, and schools, developed their own educational systems, published their own newspapers, cultivated the land, raised various crops, including tobacco and cotton. No, what mattered was that these tribes owned and controlled the richest farmland east of the Mississippi, and gold had been discovered.
Gentlemen, the President of the United States, Mr. Andrew Jackson, would like to have a word with you.
After one of the bitterest debates in the history of Congress, Jackson's Indian Removal Bill was enacted into law on May 28, 1830. Later that summer, he met with a delegation of Chickasaw leaders and told them that Congress had made a new law and that they would be compelled to remove to the West.
By act of Congress, it has been placed in my power to extend to you justice, to pay for the expenses of your removal, to support you for 12 months, and to give you tracts of land that will endure as long as the grass grows and the water runs.
I carry this implement with me always. This is a United States Army issue tomahawk, issued to the soldiers for scalping Indians. It's a device they learned from the British. The British authorities used to pay their soldiers £20 for the scalp of any Indian, any tribe. It also paid £10 for the scalp of any Indian child, any tribe, either boy or girl. General Scott is building 12 camps, stockades, concentration camps, if you will. They're open camps, open to the weather, and that's where our white brethren are putting us. And then, when we're all collected, and the whole nation is collected, save those who've gone on before us, we're to be marched. 1,000 miles, we're to be marched. There are 5,000 men coming in now to round us up, soldiers, militia, guardsmen, volunteers. They form into small groups of two or three, and they go out collecting Indians. They're being instructed to approach quietly. At mealtime, for example, General Scott suggests. So in this manner, they'll take us entirely by surprise. In this considered way, your countrymen plan to remove the entire Cherokee nation. By total surprise, remove them to the west while we sit down to supper.
And so, the Chickasaws, Cherokees, Choctaws, Creeks, and Seminoles, 14,000 souls in all, were driven like cattle through rain, snow, and summer heat. More than 4,000 died on the way, leaving a path of graves extending from the Blue Ridge Mountains of Virginia to the Oklahoma Territory known as the Trail of Tears.
The removal of the 5 civilized tribes was just the beginning of it. During the next 10 years, Andrew Jackson and his successor, Martin Van Buren, forced the signing of over 100 treaties, and through military force, deported over 125,000 woodland Indians onto the plains. By now, you're probably wondering what all this has to do with Hollywood stereotyping the Indian.
The point is really quite simple. Hollywood has never dealt adequately with the fact that Native Americans are real people.
The movies, for the most part, have perpetuated the myth of manifest destiny. The idea that might makes right has pervaded every Western film to some degree. One of the more blatant examples is MGM's How the West Was Won. In the prologue, it states, and I quote, "The West had to be won, won from nature and from primitive man." Even films that are supposedly pro-Indian, like Soldier Blue, ultimately justify the white atrocities by first setting the stage with Indians committing mindless acts of terror.
Willie!
The West, with its majestic and expansive settings, gives movie makers the room to stage endless battles and conflicts, the meat of the Hollywood Western. However, the reasons that Native Americans were forced into a brief, hopeless, life-death struggle on the plains has never been explored or explained. Instead, action has been the major concern. The word movie itself implies action, and action sells theater tickets. Most action westerns have revolved around either direct or implied confrontations with the Apache and Sioux, perhaps because the two main trails west crossed both of the respective lands. In any event, Hollywood recognized only 3 basic types of Indians, which is supported by the fact that the studios have only 3 types of Indian wardrobe.
The Sioux or Plains kit. The Apache garb. Another plus a combination of any of the 3 was used to depict over 400 other tribes.
Thus creating a Hollywood sameness for all Indians. This movie stereotype has become so effective that all you have to do is show a lurking Indian once in a while, and you create instant tension and suspense. As in The Man from Laramie, you're led to believe that this Indian is the villain. As it turns out, he's not even remotely connected to the plot. In most Westerns, the Indians are only there to provide a dramatic backdrop for the white characters to play against, as in this film. The writer's logic is difficult to follow, but basically the story is about a crooked wagon train boss who's leading a group of settlers to their land claims, which happen to be in the valley that belongs to the Arapaho tribe. The heroes undo the villain by showing that he has staked out the middle of the valley for himself. This is where it gets complicated. The Arapaho village sits right on top of the villain's land claim. Everyone oohs and ahs, perhaps out of concern for the Indians. Then it's pointed out that it is also the most valuable land because it's the only place to build a town. That's when they get mad. In any case, the Indians lose their valley, but it's okay because the bad guy eventually gets killed and the good guys take it over. At least that's how the writer sees it.
Here are your claims. And here's the Arapaho village, right in the middle, surrounded by your claims. Is it any wonder Chief Antelope and his people don't want you?
No.
Oh, just a minute. Captain Baring, you haven't marked in your claim. Where is it? I'll tell you. Right in the middle, where the Indian village is now. The only place where you people can build your town, the most profitable land in the valley.
My land is my business.
It's exactly the way the Arapaho feel. They've agreed to a meeting with you. Will you talk to them?
We're ready.
Sure, we'll talk. With bullets.
Buffy St. Marie blames white riders for the plight of Indians in movies. Would you agree that they deserve much of the blame?
Well, I would think so. In the tradition of early serials, probably, I'm not too familiar with Zane Grey, Stuart Edward White, and all the original writers of Western stories, but I imagine it's a hangover from those scripts, and I mean those original stories that were serialized, and I imagine when motion pictures started, that they still kept in that tradition.
Already in the 19th century, when James Fenimore Cooper wrote his Last of the Mohicans, you had either the romantic Indian, which was Uncas, the Last of the Mohicans, or you had the savage Indian. And when by the time the 20th century came around, and the big magazines began to run westerns about 1920, 22, when Zane Grey was big, he wrote a book called The Vanishing American. And this, again, was a romantic Indian. And the idea of the plot was that a white girl, blonde hair, blue-eyed, came out to the Navajo reservation to help the Indian. And by the end of the book, which was a serial in Ladies' Home Journal, the two of them are going to be married, and they're going to cross the two races and build a stronger race. Well, there was so much excitement and opprobrium caused by this to the general public that when they came to publish it as a novel, Harper and Brothers told Zane Grey that he had to change now. The ending of this book, he could not have them married. This was absolutely forbidden. So he has him die, Nofai, as Indian, at the end of the book. He dies, and there's this, again, romantic image, and his last words are more or less vanishing, vanishing, vanishing. Mm-hmm. By the time they came to make the movie, of course, they changed this even more and had cast Richard Dix in the role and Lois Wilson, because they too were a pair in Zane Grey Westerns, why she then took the schoolteacher part. So after the problem of the Ladies' Home Journal and Zane Grey's Vanishing American, then it became a standard magazine policy not to present a sympathetic point of view from the Indian, or much less the Indian as a central character. So that as you move into the 30s and the 40s, you have Luke Short writing a serial for the Post called Ambush. Again, it's an Apache renegade, but you never see why he's a renegade. You never understand him. You have Ernest Haycox writing Bugles in the Afternoon about Little Bighorn, but again, you never see the Indian point of view. James Warner Bella comes and writes his stories of Fort Stark and the cavalry against the Apache and the Comanche. And these stories that he wrote in the Post, John Ford used as a basis for his cavalry trilogy. But again, you can't see the Indian's point of view, and here again, it's the Post. Then comes Alan LeMay, and he writes a book called The Searchers. And he writes another one called The Unforgiven. Again, the Post is the publisher, and again, you don't see the Indian point of view. And so when Hollywood filmmakers then bought these stories to bring them to the screen, you didn't see the Indian point of view either because it wasn't in the original book. But the authors, Luke Short, Ernest Haycox, or whoever might be writing the story, couldn't do any different. If they did, the editor wouldn't buy it. And it was very lucrative, I think, more lucrative to write a magazine serial than it was to publish a book. A book might sell only 5,000 copies. Magazines paid $50,000, $60,000, $100,000 for a serial write. So you wrote it the way the editors wanted it.
The Unforgiven, directed by John Huston, is probably the most anti-Native American film ever made. And opinions of people, especially the young. The average American child spends approximately 16,000 hours watching movies and television, and only 10,000 hours in school.
And yellow hair spend wagon, soldier, and speaking wire.
Yes, Kayo. Beti digi ateko. Nichi digi ateko. Chibilicho.
Tomorrow we will be like ghosts.
This film, while not directly about Indians, treats the scenes that do concern Indians with sensitivity and accurately portrays the feelings that many tribes held toward the blacks for their participation as soldiers in the cavalry. Perhaps the reason this film presents such a positive Indian image is because the black Americans involved in it are aware of the impact of the stereotype.
We need our guns, bullets, and powder for our own fight.
Tell him his enemies are our enemies.
Nihi anahabi anahabi.
Dani hi bi khod. Bad di dene anashi. Binaika naishkaili.
You say you black people fought with that enemy against us.
I ain't in the army no more.
He knows, Buck. No guns. No bullets.
Unfortunately, for every movie like Buck and the Preacher, there are literally hundreds like this one that are shown over and over again on television screens throughout the world. Cheering for the cavalry bit just now was a little joke. But it has happened. Our children are just as susceptible to the intense feeling of sympathy for the good guy and hatred for the bad guy so skillfully generated by the makers of movie drama. What makes it understandable and even easy for our kids to root for our own people to get it is that they don't readily recognize themselves, their families, or the tribe. And the stereotype caricatures Hollywood has convinced the world are Indians.
Truth, the lost from sight, will change the world when it's finally brought to light. So we say